Washington region may not be a culinary destination like Paris or New York, but for a lot of people in the food universe with DC roots, the D area occupies a different, bigger place on their journey. Washington is cultivating chefs and restaurateurs who are committed to contributing to the fabric of the town where they grew up. From a collection of bars and hangouts that altered the city's landscape for cocktails to a neighborhood place on Barracks Row that some have described as the best new restaurant in America. Joining us to explore how our region is cultivating a culinary ecosystem is Todd Kliman. He is food and wine editor at Washingtonian and the sometime host of this broadcast. Todd, good to see you.
Good to see you again, Kojo.
Also in studio with us is Aaron Silverman. He is the chef and owner of Rose's Luxury Restaurant in Washington, D.C. Aaron, thank you for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
And Paul Ruppert is the owner of several businesses in Washington, including the Crane and Turtle and Petworth Citizen. He's also owner of Upshur Street Books. Paul Ruppert, thank you for joining us.
Glad to be here. Thank you.
Todd, before we dive into this, we should note that putting the two men next to you in the studio was your idea. And that you feel there's something exciting going on in this city right now that isn't about James Beard Awards. Wait a minute. I won. Well, the show won a James Beard Award. It's not about James Beard Award or food celebrities. It's about people who are bringing DC's DNA to what they do. What do you mean by that?
Well, you've got two tracks in the city right now, two major tracks. And one track is you have a lot of interest coming from outside the city. The city is very affluent. It's very vibrant. The economy has been really strong. And there are a lot of people looking and saying, well, there's a lot of money here. We can come in and put in a concept, not a restaurant. And steakhouses come in and big name restaurateurs come in from Philadelphia, from New York, from Los Angeles. That's interesting to a lot of people, but I think what's really exciting and what's really given this area, given this city, its kind of soul on the food scene is another track, which is homegrown talent coming up slowly, coming up naturally, organically, and starting places that are not trying to be expense account places, that are not trying to look to broad national trends. And they're not just trying to come in and set up and be a concept. They're quirky, they're personal, they're small. And what they all have in common is that they're rooted in their neighborhoods in a way that these other places are not. And that gives the city an identity. It's starting to acquire an identity because of these kinds of places.
What do you see when you walk into a place that Paul owns, like Crane and Turtle?
I see a place that doesn't look like anything else I've seen. I see a place that doesn't at first look like a restaurant. I see a place with food that French Asian food. I could be eating this at a resort restaurant with white tablecloths and stiff-backed waiters. And I'm eating it in something that looks like a former barbershop. I know it's not a barbershop, but a place that looks like that and is about as big as the studio that we're in right now. Very small, very cozy, with a staff that makes you feel as if you've come into just a fun private dinner party. And cooking that isn't trying to appeal to everybody. And I don't mean that in a negative way at all. I mean that in the best way possible. Cooking that is trying to give you something that maybe you haven't had before and is not trying to appeal to some kind of broad middle. It's going to be what it is. And if you like it, you love it. And if you don't like it, it's okay.
Aaron, people flock to Rose's Luxury these days, waiting in line for insane amounts of time to get a table. But it wasn't that long ago that you were a chef working in places like New York and Charleston who felt like he'd never come back to this area. Why did you decide to build a business here?
I decided to come back. Yeah, I mean, about, let me think, five. Now, about 6 or 7 years ago. I never thought I'd come back to D.C. I grew up in Maryland nearby, and the scene, I'd eaten at some great restaurants when I was younger, and they were incredible restaurants, but the scene wasn't for me. It was an older scene that was not quite as young and creative. And about 4 years ago, I was back on a trip and someone took me to Seasonal Pantry. And I think that was one of the kind of new young homegrown talents that was just starting to pop up that you're seeing a lot of now in the city. And I was blown away and I thought it was just such a cool idea and such a cool concept. And then I started to see, I can't remember, there was a couple other places I was shown around town. And I started, 14th Street was changing and Bar Polar was a great place. It's still a great place. And I started to see the potential for change. And I knew that I wanted to open a restaurant, whether it be New York, Charleston, or DC. And Charleston didn't make sense for a bunch of reasons. New York, I didn't want to live that lifestyle anymore. It was great when I was in my 20s. But my friends are here, my family is here. And then I noticed a difference like a spark in the DC scene. And it was passionate, often young people doing interesting things. And it had just started. There wasn't a lot of it. And we're definitely there's definitely a lot of that, a lot of growth in that area right now. And I think it's just starting to explode and it's going to continue to just exponentially grow. But I specifically remember checking out Seasonal Pantry and thinking, oh man, someone's doing something different. This is new for DC. This is fun. Maybe DC's ready for that kind of thing. And it actually ended up being, you know, before we opened, a year before we opened, 2 years before we opened, I thought that what I wanted to do would actually be a perfect fit for DC.
Well, take us back for a second. Where did food fit into your life when you were growing up in Montgomery County?
It didn't have that much impact in my life. I cooked a little with my dad. My mom cooks. She says she's a terrible cook, but she's actually a great cook. My dad, every once in a while, would cook at home, and I'd love to help him, whether it was rolling egg rolls or making chimichangas or whatever it was. As a kid, we didn't do it very often, but I did enjoy it a lot. The idea of cooking for a career came into play when I was in college.
I was about to say, you were a lousy high school student, great college student.
Yeah.
At what point in your life did you know that cooking was the path you wanted to take professionally?
You have my high school transcripts here?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. That was pretty bad. I was at an interesting school in Boston called Northeastern University, and they did a co-op program where you work for 6 months and go to school for 6 months, and you do that all year round for 5 years. And I worked for Deloitte and Touche doing auditing, Gillette doing accounting, and I was pretty unhappy doing it.
I used to work in auditing myself. I know the feeling.
Yeah. it's not bad. It was just not for me. And I was not happy doing it. And I thought to myself, you know, what's the point of life? Like, why? It's to be happy and to do what you want. And I kept asking myself, if I could do anything I wanted and I didn't have to worry about money, what would I do? And the thought of cooking came into my head because I had been watching Food Network and cooking in my apartment in Boston and enjoying it. And I thought I'd give it a shot.
800-433-8850, number to call. We're talking really about and with DC culinary talent here. Todd Kliman joins us. He's food and wine editor at Washingtonian. Aaron Silverman is the chef and owner of Rose's Luxury Restaurant in Washington, D.C. And Paul Ruppert, he's the owner of several businesses, including the Crane and Turtle and Petworth Citizen. He's also owner of Upshur Street Books. Paul Ruppert, has been said that D.C. is quite literally in your blood. When I first came to Washington in 1969 on my very first day here, I decided to open a bank account. My cousin took me to what was then American Security Bank on the corner of 7th and K Streets Northwest. And because we had to leave from near 7th and T Streets Northwest, we walked past this place that I assume was called Ruppert's Real Estate because it was spelled with two P's. I later learned that it's been called Ruppert's Real Estate. How long has your family been in Washington? And how has the family business shaped the person that you are today?
Well, the Ruppert side of the family is the German side, and they came in the 1860s. They opened up Ruppert Hardware Store there on 7th Street in 1890.
They came a century before I got here, yes.
And then after that, Ruppert Real Estate came out of that and in the 1930s. And growing up, just D.C. was central to our family, and I would spend the summers working in the real estate business, and my uncle ran the hardware store. And when I went away to school, went to college, I had a degree in European history, and I didn't know what I wanted to do with my life. So I convinced my family, and my family is you know, always interested in new things and in trying different things. And I convinced them that we should open a restaurant. So my mother and I opened up Ruppert's restaurant back in 1992. And I love certain aspects of it and kind of continued on from there.
People talk all the time about how transient a place Washington is, yet your family and many others defy that stereotype. Where do you see the contributions of the people who have roots that stretch as far back as yours in Washington? Why is it important to you to continue that tradition?
Well, I think if you look at any place, that history is really important to a place. And in Washington, there are actually quite a few Washingtonians who have grown up here and stayed here and been here a long time. My kids went through Lafayette Elementary School, which is where I went to school. And actually, there are quite a few children and even grandchildren of kids who went to Lafayette with my kids. And I think that what's great about Washington is it mixes both the old with the new. And so people who've been here a long time have kind of that base and then that new energy, which so often is people who want to change the world who come into D.C., I say, you know, come out of college and they want to, you know, make a difference. And I think that's really what attracts people to Washington. And I think that energy matched with kind of a sense of history and sense of structure really creates the vibrancy that we've seen over the last 10, 20, 30 years.
Why did you decide to convince your mom that the family should open a restaurant?
We had, like many families, we had always talked about opening a restaurant, just like we talked about many different things as kids around the dining table. And it sounded like a great fun idea. Now, the very first day that we opened, I was waiting tables, I realized, well, I actually like the part of opening restaurants and creating them. The waiting tables part of it, I wasn't so crazy about. So it was really just, you know, my parents were game, you know, and eventually we opened it as an American home style restaurant, but it really took off when we found a fantastic chef in John Cochran, who is this great artist, and Sidra Foreman, and great, just a great, fantastic cook. And he was doing really interesting things with Ruppert's. And eventually we actually sold the restaurant to John and to Sidra, and they took it on to even more heights from there.
How would you describe the neighborhood you were trying to serve at the time? Was the convention center even open yet?
No, the convention center wasn't open. It wasn't
even. People should know it's right across the street from the convention center on 7th Street.
That's right. And when we were starting this process, we had a restaurant equipment salesman come in to give us a bid, and he looked at us and he was like, you want to open a restaurant here? But you know, we're committed to DC, and it's interesting because people talk about how terrible DC was and how dangerous it was, and for us that's what it was, that's what DC was. And so, you know, we were there before the Verizon Center or before the convention center, but you know, I just remember going down there during the summers and working in the real estate office. And that's, you know, that was just, it was just home to us.
And I was about to say that even though the convention center wasn't open yet and the neighborhood was significantly different than it is now, it was always very close to the downtown of Washington. And in the final analysis, it was your neighborhood.
That's right. You know, my family, my grandfather was actually born above the hardware store. And that was a German neighborhood right there. And their church was St. Mary's Church down at 5th and H. And they went to school there. And so there was that really immediate connection to the neighborhood.
Got to take a short break. If you have called, stay on the line. We have several calls. But if you'd like to call, the number is 800-433-8850. You can send email to kojo@wamu.org. You can go to our website, kojoshow.org, and watch the live video stream of this conversation. Or you can shoot us a tweet at @kojoshow. I'm Kojo Nandi. Welcome back to our conversation on DC culinary talent. We're talking with Aaron Silverman. Aaron Silverman is the chef and owner of Rose's Luxury Restaurant, and Paul Ruppert is the owner of several businesses, including the Crane and Turtle and Petworth Citizen. He's also owner of Upshur Street Books. Todd Kliman is food and wine editor at the Washingtonian. I'd like to go directly to the phones and talk with Daniel in Washington, D.C. Daniel, you're on the air. Go ahead, please.
Hey, Kojo. Hey, Aaron. So this is Daniel Everson. I just couldn't resist the opportunity to make you feel awkward in the public setting.
Oh, awesome. Thank you.
Of course. So Aaron and I worked for a couple of the same chefs growing up, and we both grew up in the area, and I wanted to get his opinion on how small producers in the area have kind of crafted the dining scene and the area coming up.
Which is the whole point of the show. Go ahead, please, Aaron.
I'm sorry, Daniel. Can you say that one more time? What was your question? I was just so distracted by the fact that you actually called it.
How small producers in this area have crafted.
Yeah, farms more specifically, but really, you know, more on the production side than necessarily in the run side.
I unfortunately, as much as I'd love to answer your question, I don't have that much to contribute to it. I'm still I'm still new to this city in the sense of running a business. You know, we've been open for a year and a half, and I spent probably the last year and a half running around like a maniac, and the year and a half before that doing the same thing, trying to get the restaurant up and running. I do know that when we opened, we started with generic produce companies, generic products that we're buying that everybody else buys. And as we've settled in, we've been able to switch to good co-ops, nice farms, smaller artisanal products. We have some of your honey around right now that we're working on a new dessert with. So as time goes on, we're starting to settle in a little and really make use of the really personal, interesting, kind of handcrafted or hand-grown or whatever products that we can. The whole scene, I unfortunately don't have that much to contribute to that.
But Daniel, thank you very much for your call. Todd, you wrote that Roses is an increasingly rare thing. It's an original. What did you mean by that?
That it's a restaurant that doesn't, you know, as we were talking about with Crane and Turtle, it's a restaurant that doesn't look to other restaurants so much for what it does. You go to a lot of restaurants, and I remember that as in the review, and I opened up by talking about what you kind of expect when you go to a moderately priced restaurant with a certain kind of design in a certain kind of a neighborhood with a kind of crowd, late 20s, early 30s. And it's not like that. The food doesn't look like that. The staff doesn't act like you expect them to act. The entire MO of Roses seems to me to downplay everything, but not in this kind of falsely humble way, but in order for you to come in and make a discovery, so that you come in and you say, wow, this, look at this place, and you then feel proprietary about it. You then feel that it's yours. And this is very unusual in this city. And when it opened, I think it was very unusual. You see this around the country a lot. A lot of restaurants are trying to bring you to them in a way that lets you experience them as if for the first time. And that's a pretty wonderful thing.
And you get the feeling, as you said, you get the proprietary feeling that, hey, I discovered this. It's mine.
And then you go out and you tell everybody.
Now legions can now say the same thing. Aaron, what kind of culture did you try to establish in your kitchen? And how do you keep that going with your cooks? You've talked a lot about the importance of your cooks contributing creatively to what you do.
Just to touch on Todd just said there, I mean, one of the things we've tried to do since the beginning is just, there's a line at the end of one of the El Bulli cookbooks, and the line is on the back of the cookbook, it says, it's just dinner. And that's kind of stuck with me for a while. And in the end, that's all we're really doing is serving people dinner and trying to keep that in mind. And we never tried to be like a thing. We just tried to be a really good restaurant that serves good food and good service. And just realizing what we do, not trying to be famous or popular or trendy, just trying to serve really good dinner at a really good price with really good service. That's part of kind of our culture that we've instilled within the staff, front and back of the house. But more specifically, you asked about cooks and the kitchen culture. I've been through some tough kitchens. Most of my managers have been through some tough kitchens, yelling, screaming, verbal abuse, physical abuse, I mean, you name it. And none of us really enjoyed that. And we thought, you know, we took a gamble when we opened that there's a better way to do things. None of us had really experienced it before, but we thought that it would be possible, which is, sounds ridiculous, but treating people with respect. And it doesn't mean that we don't discipline when we need to, trusting our staff. It's hard to trust back of the house staff. It's a different situation because they're following specific directions versus giving the front of the house trust with the guests. They're following recipes, they're following procedures, but acting as teachers towards them as opposed to drill sergeants. And
allowing them to have input.
Yes, absolutely. So all of my sous chefs have input on half the menus theirs. It definitely has my editing and my my touch in it, but half the menu is theirs. They come up with ideas and dishes, and if it was just my idea, it'd be pretty limited. So it's better for everyone. They get to experiment and have fun and grow, and the restaurant does better as a whole because we have, in this case, five heads are better than one.
Paul Ruppert?
I think that really sets apart Rose's Luxury, at least from the outside, is that feeling of that sense of collective that when you go there, and Aaron actually worked with us a little bit before he opened Rose's. He worked at Hogo as a guest chef for us. That was a rum bar that we had on 7th Street. And you could really see that it was this great collaboration between him and really everyone in the kitchen. And then even when you go there, you have a feeling that everyone from the first person that greets you to people clearing your plates or bringing your food, that they all have a sense of ownership. And I think that's beyond that the food is delicious and the beverage program is fantastic. I think that's really what sets Rose's apart, at least in my mind.
See, that's really a part of DC's cultural DNA. Everybody here knows each other. You get that impression? Don't you get that impression?
Well, and to piggyback off what Aaron's talking about, is it's, you go into certain places and you can't always tell what is it that makes us so good. Why do I like being here? And the reason is in a lot of cases, it's because morale is good. A lot of people will come to me and they'll complain. They'll say, I had a bad meal. The server was indifferent. The server was neglectful. And a lot of that just flows from the top. And it flows from a sense of lack of camaraderie or the amount of camaraderie. And when you have an operation that's really tight, collegial, warm, where people are looking out for each other. First of all, you can see it on the floor. If you ever, you know, signal with your hand to flag down a waiter or waitress, and you see that person go by, or you see another waiter or waitress go by, maybe it's not a bad restaurant, but it's not a restaurant that's operating the way it could or should. If you see somebody who's not your waiter or waitress, who then comes over and asks what they can, that's teamwork, and that's what you get at these smaller places. You have a sense of what Paul talked about, which is ownership, and a sense that everybody's in this. It's a collective. Yes, there's a head guy, but there's something more. And these kind of rooted neighborhood restaurants really pride themselves on that, in part because they have to. They have to be different. They have to be different from the slicker, more corporatized restaurants with deep pockets.
On to the issue of relations with David in Washington, D.C. David, you are on the air. Go ahead, please.
Hi, Kojo. Great show, as always. I had a question for your guests. I've noticed in my very limited experience going out that more and more restaurants are not taking reservations, including Rose's Luxury. And I've had a good experience with that and a really bad experience with that. And I'm wondering what's causing the trend towards this, especially in nicer establishments. Obviously, with fast food or the quick meal preparation, they don't need a reservation.
To the point where they don't even allow their parents to make reservations. But I'll allow Aaron Silverman to handle that.
I mean, let me start by saying that actually our new restaurant is going to take reservations.
And we'll talk about that in a second.
But, I mean, everyone has different reasons for not taking reservations. It depends on the operator. I can speak to our reasons. there's a bunch of them. I've been through this many times. One of the biggest ones, there's two major points, and actually there's three major points, and those are: when you take reservations, you have to essentially at some point you're going to have to kick somebody out of their seat, because you have, if they're hanging out and having a good time with friends and they run late and they're there, say they show up at 5:30 and they're done at, and they should be done at 7:30 or 8, but they want to hang around longer, you're eventually going to have to kick them out, because then someone else is waiting for that table. And how do you tell someone who made their reservations weeks in advance that their table's not ready? They made it weeks in advance. So it really, our biggest thing is being hospitable and taking care of people, and kicking people out of their seats to me is not very hospitable. So that's the first point. The second point is, it does help keep prices low, which is something many people have said before. But because it keeps your seats full, and the busier you are, the more money you make, the lower the price you can charge. We try and keep our prices as low as possible. I think we're in our sweet spot right now, which is where we're settling in. Most things are between $12 and $13. We could do less covers a night and charge more to meet our targets. But the busier you are, the lower you can keep your prices. We're not successful financially because we charge so much for our food. It's because we're busy all the time. And the third reason is that it's better for the neighbors. And it was the whole idea of this restaurant was to be a neighborhood restaurant. I couldn't count on people coming from other parts of the city, other parts of the other states, other wherever to show up. You can't bank on that as a restaurant opening. And I live in the neighborhood. I live across the street, and I lived there for a year before the restaurant opened. And I love the neighborhood, and I just wanted to build a place that all the neighbors could come to. And it benefits the neighbors, because if we took reservations, I mean, who knows? We could be booked 3, 4, 6, 8, 12 weeks a year in advance. And if you wanted to come to Rose's tonight, there's no way you could do it. But if you want to go to Rose's tonight, you can absolutely guaranteed 100% get in. You may have to wait in line a little, but if you wanted to go tonight, you can definitely get in. And that benefits the neighbors because they live nearby. So it makes it a lot easier for them.
David, thank you very much for your call. If you'd like to see photos of the Rose's luxury team preparing for a dinner shift, you can go to our website, kojoshow.org, where rep producer Ruth Tam and photographer Anthony Washington offer a peek inside the restaurant. That's at our website, kojoshow.org. You can also join the conversation there. Paul, last year you launched a project aimed at a different piece of cultural life here in the District of Columbia. You opened a bookstore. Why was this something you wanted to do?
So I love to do interesting projects, and I love to work with really talented people. There's been a resurgence over the last few years in other cities of having these new small independent bookstores. They've been able to take advantage of changes in the book industry, where some of the bigger stores like Barnes & Noble and Borders have been having difficulty. And similar to what we do in our restaurants is what we're doing in the bookstore, Upshur Street Books, is we're creating, basically we have a vision that we want to share with folks that we think resonates with folks, that of an independent bookstore that focuses on things like the arts and literary fiction and poetry and other kind of interesting things. And so that's what I like to do, is to do interesting projects, not just in the restaurant world, but other places too.
How was the challenge of opening a bookstore, well, different from opening a restaurant?
From a build-out perspective, it's actually quite easier, a lot easier, because you don't have to do the health inspections, you don't have to build out a kitchen, that sort of thing. Really the challenge is not opening a bookstore, but it's getting your customers to come in and spend money. We all know that Amazon is very easy, but you know, you can even call up Anna, our manager there at Upshur Street Books, and she'll order a book and they'll get it in 2 days as well. So, but that's the challenge.
On your opening day at the bookstore, you had the Rose's Luxury experience, people lining up outside the store to get in. That's got to be very encouraging.
Yeah, that was fantastic. It was a great opening day.
And it's my understanding that you met your wife decades ago at an Olson's bookstore.
That's right. Yep. Mm-hmm. She worked at the Olson's down on 7th Street.
Had to open a bookstore as a tribute to
her. I miss Olson's.
I miss Olson's too. That was a great bookstore.
On to the phones again. Here now is Naeem in Tysons Corner, Virginia. Naeem, you're on the air. Go ahead, please.
Hi, guys. I just wanted to, I guess, piggyback on that, what Aaron was talking about of ownership, and what led to his decision, I guess, or what was his thought process in offering his employees, his staff, health insurance, which is, for me at least, I think it's kind of uncommon to see in the restaurant business, especially as we all know that they operate on such thin margins to begin with. Could you elaborate on some of that?
Sure. Yeah. We decided, or I guess I decided that I wanted to run my business differently. I wanted to surround myself with people that I enjoyed working with. And I was going to, you know, I have a 20-year lease and I was going to be working with in this building with people for 20 years. And I wanted to, A, surround myself with people that I enjoyed being around, and B, make them happy so that we all had a pleasant time working together. And one of the biggest pieces of that was compensation, whether it be benefits or pay or there's a bunch of other things we do, but specifically health insurance was a huge one for me. And I kind of fought with my parents about it a little bit, because they wondered how it would be possible to afford to pay for health insurance 100% for all of our employees. And I pushed pretty hard on it, and I stuck with it. And to me, it wasn't about retaining great people or keeping the best people around or attracting great people. It was just about the right thing to do. And I grew up in this industry. I spent the last 10 years in this industry, and it's really tough. And I think it's a lot tougher than it needs to be. And it can be very unfair. And we're trying to change the game a little bit and make it prove that it is possible to do a bunch of the right things in the restaurant industry that often get overlooked. And it's expensive, but it's worth it 100%, I think.
Don't find that a whole lot in the restaurant industry, do you? Healthcare?
Almost never. Yeah. Almost never. It goes back to what we're talking about creating camaraderie and boosting morale. And it's, you see it at these places. And I think part of what is so interesting to me to look at is how it's not, there are not a lot of these places that we're talking about. They're not looking, you know, Aaron was talking before about, you know, thinking just about that neighborhood. This place transcended its original purpose and became a national level place.
It's a destination now.
A destination for people traveling from all over the country now. But that's not what it set out to be. And what's interesting to me about these places is that they look to the city, and not even the city. I mean, one of the things we haven't really touched on is that the city is so strange, because you've got the federal city and you've got the actual city, the city that your show
neighborhoods.
Yeah, is meant to reinforce and to speak to. And these restaurants are DC. They're the district, as opposed to the corporate town, the company town, the official Washington that we all read about. These restaurants aren't looking to that at all. They're not looking to those kinds of diners. I'm not saying that that's motivating the decision to not have reservations, but when you don't have reservations, you are able to appeal to people who see this as a place to live, a place they put down roots, and a place where they belong. That gives a restaurant something different, and that gives a scene like this something different, something it really hasn't had.
We had a caller who couldn't stay on the line, who identifies as a local musician, who says, do you ever think of using local musicians in any of your establishments, starting with you, Paul?
We do a little bit of music at Petworth Citizen. We have a great reading room in the back of that space on Upshur Street. And we, for instance, once a month, we have a bluegrass jam that happens in there. We've had some other music that's happened in there. And of course, in the past, when we had the Passenger in the Warehouse Theater down on 7th Street, we did a wide range of performance and music down there as well.
Aaron?
We thought about live music. It would be fantastic and incredible and a dream come true. I think for us, it's not quite feasible. I'm pretty sure our liquor license might even prohibit us from that. But it's an incredible, live music's incredible. But space and time constraints for us are probably not in the cards.
Got to take a short break. If you've called, stay on the line. If you'd like to, the number is 800-433-8850. What do you think restaurants contribute to the cultural DNA of a place like the District of Columbia? You can also shoot us an email to kojo@wamu.org, or go to our website, where you can also see, as I mentioned earlier, photos of the Roses Luxury Team preparing for a dinner shift. You can also shoot us a tweet at Kojo Show. I'm Kojo Nandi.
What I want, you got it in mind.
We're talking about DC Culinary Talent with DC Culinary Talent. Aaron Silverman is the chef and owner of Rose's Luxury Restaurant, and Paul Ruppert is the owner of several businesses, including the Crane and Turtle and Petworth Citizen. He's also owner of Upshur Street Books. Todd Kliman is food and wine editor at Washingtonian. Aaron, you mentioned this earlier. You're planning on a new project on 8th Street Southeast, where you will be taking reservations. Tell us about that.
So we've signed a lease on the building right next to Rose's, and we're going to be opening a restaurant sometime early next year. It's going to be very small compared to Rose's, about a third of the size. So we're going to have 7 tables, about 30 seats. We're going to be open 4 nights a week, actually closed on Saturdays and Sundays, which is kind of bizarre, but we have our reasons. And Saturday, Sunday, Monday. It's going to be expensive. It's going to be a fine dining restaurant, but it'll be worth it.
It's going to be fancy, but not formal. Make that distinction for us, please.
It's fine dining, but it's kind of our style of fine dining. And I think what that means is that it's very elegant. It's very refined. It's very fancy, but not formal. For me, formal is uncomfortable. It's being... not wanting to talk too loud because the person next to you might hear you when you hit your fork against a glass, feeling uncomfortable that like you made too loud of a noise. Formality creates uncomfortable situations. So trying to do things that are very elegant, refined, and because those are luxuries, they're very enjoyable, but trying to remove anything that detracts from pleasure. And for me, and I think a lot of people, the formality that comes along with fine dining often definitely detracts from the pleasure of it.
How will the wait staff be attired?
That's a good question. We've been discussing that one a lot recently. I think they're definitely going to have some say of their own, like they do at Rose's. It definitely won't be as casual as Rose's. I think the new restaurant's going to be very, very similar to Rose's in its heart and in its soul, but it's just going to be probably more dialed in.
Get your high heel sneakers ready. Here is Andrew in Washington, D.C. Andrew, you are on the air. Go ahead, please.
Hi, thank you. Good afternoon. This question is mostly for Aaron, though it will apply to Paul's situation, and I happen to be acquainted with Paul through some work I did for the city government several years back. I'm happy for Aaron and what Rose's Luxury has accomplished. Kudos to you. But in opening a new restaurant, it's likely, if not certain, you'll displace a retail neighborhood business on Barracks Row. And you talked about neighborhood. You've talked about, quality and standards and doing things differently. A neighborhood's made up of varying types of businesses, bookstores, retail businesses, perhaps an alcohol business like a liquor or wine store. And not just restaurants, because restaurants aren't open all those hours. And for a neighborhood to be complete, it has to have a variety of businesses. So how do you cope with, how do you deal with, and what do you think about the fact that a good and ongoing neighborhood retail business is going to be displaced by your new restaurant?
So actually, the owners of that business are very, very close friends of mine and neighbors, and have been very, very good dear friends to me since I moved into the neighborhood. So deciding to take over their lease after it ran out was really, really difficult situation for me. I had the worst stomach. I couldn't sleep. My stomach was turning for months and months. In the end, one way or another, they were moving out. So we said, if somebody's going to go in, we'd rather it be us. But to speak to losing retail, yeah, as much as I'm excited to do what I want to do next door, it's also kind of sucks to have retail slowly disappearing a little bit. And I think there's a bigger issue there, but I know for us down the road, we have got tons of ideas. We'd love to do an ice cream shop. We'd love to do a movie theater. We'd love to do a plant store. We've got lots and lots of passions that aren't necessarily restaurants or food related, even, that we'd like to do.
Well, I know a restaurateur who opened a bookstore. He can also.
Yeah, I'm jealous, actually, very jealous, because that was one of our ideas. But I think, it's a bigger issue. It's about the rents and market and what landlords are willing to accept and what tenants are able to pay. It's tough. Retail's tough with with Amazon and all the other online shopping. It's it's difficult. I'm still trying to figure out how to handle that.
Well, one part of the ways you handle it, Paul, is by opening a bookstore. But how do you go about keeping your projects grounded as places that are there, as Aaron was pointing out, because of the lack of reservations, essentially to serve neighbors?
So I think you first start off by creating places to think your neighbors will like to go to. So that's really where I come from. And our next project is in that same Petworth neighborhood. It's going to be called Slim's Diner, and it's opening in July. And one of the things that we did is we actually did a survey of the neighborhood, an online survey, and we had over 825 responses to that survey in just a week's time. And we asked things like, you know, do you like backs on your stools or no backs on your stools? Or do you like a television in your diner or no television in your diner? And obviously, we make those ultimate decisions, but having that input has been really helpful for us to put in a business that responds to a neighborhood's wants and desires.
Todd, how would you define the idea of a neighborhood restaurant? And do you think it's an appropriate label for places like Roses and Crane and Turtle?
You know, I have misgivings about the term, because to me, a neighborhood restaurant, a real neighborhood restaurant, is a place like the White Dog Cafe in Arlington or Franklin's in Hyattsville, where you could go in sweatpants just after a workout. People all know who you are. They can anticipate your order. These are neighborhood restaurants in quotes. I mean, I think what they're doing is fantastic, and it represents something different. But I think it has to be understood in the context of this city historically and the tradition of dining out in America. This city historically has been very starchy, very conservative, very expense account. What these places represent is a real break. And just to piggyback off what Paul was talking about, this approach of being responsive to your patch of land, to just give everyone a sense of how extraordinary that is. I want to tell a quick story about when a restaurant named West End Bistro opened.
He's never told a quick story in his life.
Oh, gosh. Well, this will be quick. West End Bistro opened with a chef, Eric Repair, who is of some renown. And I remember spending some time up at the offices of Le Bernardin, where they were concepting this restaurant. And on the whiteboard, they had the menu written out, and they wanted to do a salad. Now, one of the restaurants that they're working on was going to have a green market salad. Green market is the massive market in Manhattan where a lot of chefs go, and it goes on for blocks and blocks and blocks. It's got extraordinary produce. On the menu, on the whiteboard for this restaurant that was going to be opening was Eastern Market Salad. As anyone knows who's been to Eastern Market's tiny, and it's not a place where chefs are going to source product. That just reveals a fundamental disconnect between place and venture. And it's not what you're getting with these places.
That was a short story. Congratulations.
Thank you very much. I'm learning.
Back to the telephones. Here is Ruthie in Hyattsville, Maryland. Ruthie, you're on the air. Go ahead, please.
Thank you. I work for a local charity. I've been there for about 10 years now, and our nonprofit, it's been very interesting to discover that we get so much support from local businesses. We actually collect donations of building materials, and the local nurseries like Banky's and Johnson's and Campbell and Ferrara, they could hold wonderful collections for us versus the big box retailers, which maybe sometimes will give 10-50 bucks maybe to an Eagle Scout. I don't know. It just seems like they don't have such a connection to the local charities and really supporting community. And I suspect the same is true in the restaurant business in this town. I'm curious if that's the case.
Paul?
Hi, Ruthie. We I think you're from Community Forklift. Is that right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Good to hear your voice. We actually have gotten a lot of material from Community Forklift, which I think if your listeners don't know, it's a great resource for donated material. And so we've used that material in a number of our restaurants. To answer your question, so we get a lot of requests from, you know, schools, from, you know, local neighborhood events. We have a Celebrate Petworth event coming up in June, for instance, and we really do our best to give small donations to almost anyone who asks. I'm maybe we'll regret saying that on air, but we do have a budget for that, and we try to say yes, and we try to say yes in small ways that won't break the bank, but it is important that we do our part in helping other organizations succeed.
Thank you very much for your call, Ruthie. Karen, to what degree does your interest in all of the things involved with your business either contribute to or distract from your attention to the food? You've got your hands on everything from the decor, and it's my understanding that you have listened to each of the more than 2,000 songs on the playlist even before the opening of the restaurant?
Yeah, it's a lot. I'm actually doing that again right now for the new restaurant, listening to 100 songs a day. But
when?
I don't know, in my sleep. But I enjoy all aspects of the restaurant, and so I try and keep my hand involved with all of them. It definitely, there's only so much time in a day, so it definitely limits how much time I have for the food and sleep. So I've tried to surround myself with a really good team who can support me, and we can work together, who are smart, talented people to work on food and dishes together. I definitely a large portion of the menu is mine, but I do a lot of editing these days and guidance for my sous chefs and younger cooks to learn how to create dishes. So giving them a voice on our menu is great for them, and it also frees me up a little to do some of the things that I want to do, whether it be music or design. With the new restaurant, part of the reason we're only going to be open 4 days is because of a lesson I learned at Rose's, which is if you're open 6 days a week, the seventh day, you're usually there on your day off anyways. You have no time to experiment or play around or test recipes or really think about food. We've been very reactive for the last year and a half and haven't had a chance to really have a clear thought. So the idea with the new restaurant is that we'd be closed a couple of days, so we would spend at least one day strictly for experimentation and playing around with ingredients and recipes, and so dedicating more time to food.
You may have noticed that in our breaks in the show today, we were playing the music of Hall & Oates.
I did.
That's because you gave your staff a day off to actually go and see Hall & Oates perform at one point. How important is that music thing to the ambience of the place?
Very
important.
Because
the owner to listen to
edit. I think it's very important. I think all the details are important. I mean, down to the soap in the bathroom, the smile that is or isn't on the lips of the host or hostess, the way you're seated, the way somebody's thumb is off the plate but not on the plate. All these things really add up, and you may not notice them individually, but you notice, you're aware of them, and they create that experience.
In the neighborhood. Todd Kliman is food and wine editor at Washingtonian. Always a pleasure.
Thank you, Coach.
Aaron Silverman is the chef and owner of Rose's Luxury Restaurant in Washington, D.C. Aaron, thank you for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
And Paul Ruppert is the owner of several businesses, including the Crane and Turtle and Petworth Citizen. He's also owner of Upshur Street Books. Paul, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you very much, Dan.
And thank you all for listening. Coming up tomorrow on the Kojo and the show, DC's independent music scene is eclectic and inclusive.